next talk starts about Ericsson RVS series. I think we're a little bit ahead of schedule, which is not a problem. I'm sure we will manage to do some more over budget with some other talks. So RVS 6000 series, what is this? It's a very popular series of radio base stations. RVS is the Ericsson terminology for base stations during the last decade. I don't really know when exactly they were introduced and so on. It's not my primary research topic. But they are quite current, so it's not like 1990s technology, but it's rather, I think the earliest references I could find are maybe 10 years old from now, so it's basically in the last decade and not two or three decades ago. And they are built from various different modules, some of them, digital units DU and radio units RU, of course, not like my slide erroneously claims. And then here are all kinds of miscellaneous bits like shelves, racks, fans, fuse boxes, overvoltage protection, cables, power supply units, and so on. And from those modules, you can build either classic BTS cabinets where the entire radio is in some kind of cabinet, or you can also drive these remote radio units, the tower-mounted radios from that. And you can think a bit of it like Lego for base stations. This is basically the different base stations that you can build from those units or these particular building blocks in terms of RVSs. So this is a really large one, the 6102. 6101 is half a 6102, as you can easily see. There's a 6201. I'm not sure what exactly is different about that one. There's a 6202, which is, again, just one unit that would go in one of these racks. Then you have a 6601 that doesn't have radio units, but only digital units, so use it with remote radio heads. And then you have remote radio units in different form factors here attached to it. And the individual different configurations that you put together, yeah, that's why this says think of it as Lego, and somehow this, yeah, I need to rescale this so it fits on the slide. So basically we have radio units and digital units. We build from them digital building blocks and radio building blocks, and they combine to so-called radio configurations, and then they are used in RVS types. And that allows you to have quite some flexible configurations, not only 2G, but also 3G and 4G, and combined configurations, and three sector setups, six sector setups, and all kinds of different, with diversity and without diversity, and you can have coherent transmission combination, TCC, coherent transmitter combination, so you can double the RF output power by having two coherent amplifiers. You can go up to 80 watts of GSM. If you want. Okay, let's look at one of these racks, how they look like in the RVS. We basically have, it's actually really a 19-inch rack with different shelves in there. This is an HU rack, and this is another HU, 8U, unit. And you can see on the left-hand side there are radio, the digital units, there are two small digital units here, like the LTE and GSM one, and this one here is a two-slot-wide radio unit, which is the 3G radio digital unit, sorry. And then we have the individual radios here. So you can see there are six radios, which means two radios per sector in a three-sector side, plus the digital unit next to it. And then this is just power, and the transmission means microwave backhaul or some optical backhaul or whatever in there. Now, why am I... okay, let's look at the details. So this is a very JPEG compression artifact affected picture of one of these blocks in here. So we have these tomorrow at in Berlin. I have some real hardware, so you can look at the real hardware. This is a 3G digital unit and six radio units next to it, like you would find them in such a BTS. So in terms of 2G technology, there's two generations of such modules. One is the DUG10 and the RUG, Duck and Ruck, how we say in German. And the they resemble the earlier RVS 2000 architecture. The DUC is like an IXU or DXU, if you ever heard about the earlier BTS generations. And basically, this means they do the OML, they terminate all the E1 lines. And then you have the RUC, the radio unit, which is basically the transceiver. It includes the baseband transceiver, the modulation, demodulation, encoding, decoding, the up conversion, the power amplifier, and so on. But it's entire transceivers. And the interconnection between those two units is still a TDM link, so a TDM link with more or less E1 style. It's also 2 megabit symmetric. I don't think it's really E1 that they're using there. But it's not a baseband sample interface, which is only introduced later on. But let's look at this DUC 10 and DUC 10. The interesting factor is that these two devices, the smallest possible configuration, you can these days get for about, if you're good, up for about €300, both of them together. From a refurbished, so basically all of these units, they are removed in large quantities in the field in site decommissioning these days. And you can go to one of these companies that do site decommissioning and a trade in refurbished and so on, used equipment. And for about €150 for the digital unit and €150 for the radio unit, you can get basically a GSM base station that can, I think, physically go up to 60 watts, might be software limited to 20 watt transmit power, and is quite capable. So that's really why I find this equipment quite interesting, because you get high-end, high MTBF, high-quality equipment for a very low price. The digital unit 10, the DUC, can actually do 12 TRXs, so many more TRXs than any of the equipment that we support so far, and that we have used traditionally. It has no baseband processing inside, it's just protocol logic, and it has so-called HSIO, high-speed I.O. connectors for the interface to the radio unit, and it has 4 E1 T1 ports to the for the backhaul. It's... Oh, why is the picture not there? That's quite unfortunate. Let me quickly see what's happening there. Why is there no... Somehow this picture is missing. Other pictures are there, so we have... Okay. Somehow the picture is gone. Maybe I forgot to check it into Git. Sorry for that. So we have the digital unit, and this is actually the radio unit. It's an RUG, not a DUG. It's GSM only. You have 2 TRXs in hardware, 40 watt per TRX if you don't combine it, and 22 watts per TRX if you combine it with the internal hybrid combiner. So quite a lot of RF output power for a macro base station. Has very nice sensitivity. It has receive diversity and so on. So really, really high-end model. The second generation that they came out with is the DUG20, and that goes with a RUS radio unit. No Ericsson documentation ever states what S stands for. They say it's multi-standard, but then why is it not M but S? But anyway, the second generation models, and the difference is basically that all the baseband processing has now moved into the DUC, and the interface between the DUC and the RUC, the RUS in this case, is baseband samples. So you have a CPRI or CPRI link between the digital unit and the radio unit, and you just exchange 12-bit IQ samples over CPRI between those two units. And you use SFP, a short format pluggable optical transceivers, or if the distance is close enough, you can also do copper-based cables. And the links, depending on exactly how many transceivers you use on such a device, they run with 1.25 or 2.5 gigabits for these baseband links. The digital unit, again, has 12 TRX, which you can group up to 1 to 6 BTSs. You have baseband processing in there, you have the SFP slots, and again you have 4 E1, T1, J1 links on RJ45 connectors. Interestingly, it's multiplexed on 2 RJ45 because there simply was no space left to add additional connectors on this small form factor. So they had basically to put 2 E1 links on 1 RJ45 connector. the radio unit that goes with it, the RUS is not GSM specific, but it supports any, it's GSM, WCDMA and LTE, and it can carry four RF carriers, each of them 20 megahertz instantaneous bandwidth. Ah, yeah, Mulit, of course. You can either have up to 80 watt out of one such a unit. 20 watt you get without additional license keys, but anything beyond 20 watts you need Ericsson license keys or some other method of convincing it to transmit more. The RUS 02 is a successor of the RUS 01, which then has 40 megahertz instantaneous bandwidth, so you can have more space between your GSM carriers or have more bandwidth LTE, but we're looking at GSM here in this case. And you can again have up to four carriers, but GSM you could actually have eight. So with a RUS 02 and a DUC 20, you could actually put eight TRXs in, you have an eight TRX BTS. Just out of two of those elements. For UMTS, you have a DUW. I think you can somehow figure out the G was for GSM, the W for WCDMA, the digital unit for WCDMA. And again, you use it with the RUS, the same radio unit, to have 3G carriers. But the problem is it only has IUB to an RNC, and we don't have any RNC open source. Well, nobody has any open source RNC implementation. So it's not very interesting for doing 3G. Because somebody would need to implement an RNC, and I don't think that's going to happen anymore these days. So 3G I find not so interesting. For LTE, you can have a DUL, the digital unit LTE, plus again a RUS radio unit multi-standard, and you can combine those then in different configurations. So this is basically how Ericsson describes, for example, a combined WCDMA and GSM setup. So you have the digital unit for 3G, you have the digital unit for GSM here, and you connect both of them to each of your three radio units. And you have three sectors again, one radio unit per sector. And then this way you have a three-sector setup for 2G and 3G. And if you put a DUL here instead of the DUV, you have the same for LTE plus GSM, a multi-standard BTS. You can also basically do this with more transceivers by combining them and by then having six radio units instead of four. And then you have these nice cross connects here at the bottom for diversity reception, because then you have, what is it, how many dB gain do we get from diversity? Two times diversity, I don't know. But anyway, you have the diversity gain at this point. Involved. And you can still drive, and that's why there's always six radio links interfaces here, or CPRI interfaces on those digital units, so you can have such a setup with all the interconnections. Now, the next step in the evolution is the DUS, that's the digital unit multi-standard, which basically is a digital unit that has 2G, 3G, and 4G capability in there. Which can actually go to 24 GSM TRX, so not only 12, as if 12 TRX was not ridiculous number of TRXs already. Or you can run 12 TRX GSM plus LTE at the same time in the same digital unit. It's the same form factor. It's a rather small device. You can see tomorrow. It's basically full of FPGAs and proprietary ASICs. Yeah, and there's a DUS 41 even that can do 48 GSM transceivers out in one such small box. So if you really want to go for ridiculous capacity GSM macro cells, that's what you can do. And this is also the first generation of units where they don't have E1 anymore. So anything up to the DUC, DUC 10, DUC 20, still has E1, and the DUS then finally has Ethernet only. And I presume they implemented something like the site integration unit internally. The SIU is an external component from Ericsson that you can use to encapsulate E1 ABIS links and transport them over IP. So basically they take the LAPD frames and encapsulate them over a proprietary derivative of L2TP, and then this L2TP is sent over IP over Ethernet on the other side, and they just move this unit into, I think, into the DUS, so you don't need it as an external unit anymore. The DUS are slightly more expensive, so the DUS 31, DUS 41, I think you pay about 600 euros for them, but then still I think it's ridiculously low money for something that can do GSM, UMTS and LTE at the same time. So still something interesting to look at. So How does the Ericsson support look like in Osmocom? We have a history of RBS 2000 support. That's the earlier generation of 2G base stations from Ericsson. We have what's called an OM2000 implementation. That's their organization and maintenance link. And of course, Osmo BSC inherits that, what we had in NITB, but it breaks voice, as we just discussed. The media gateway doesn't have EV1 support yet. We have already introduced, I think about 1.5 years ago, a PCU socket in the BSC, because in the Ericsson architecture, the PCU is not at the BTS, but it's at the BSC. So that's also already supported in the BSC. And so once we have the E1 interface again at the media gateway, I think we should be very well prepared to making those RBX 6000 components to work in the Osmocom stack. And the only thing that's really missing now is an inexpensive E1 adapter, and preferably one that doesn't require PCI or PCIe. Because there is exactly zero devices out there on the market that do something like USB to E1 and are supported by either DADI or MISDN. So you can find some very expensive USB E1 interfaces that people use for protocol tracing when they're in the field and dealing with legacy TDM, but then those come with a proprietary Windows protocol analyzer software, and of course they're not supported by any kind of Linux drivers or so. And again, they're expensive. So if you pay only 300 euros for your entire GSM base station, you don't want to pay 400 euros for the E1 card. That's sort of disproportionate. And that brings us to the idea for a software-defined E1 interface, which is in the next talk. But before we go there, do we have questions about the Ericsson support? Keith, I think, has a question. Not sure where the microphone went. It's over there.
Yeah, so I know we discussed this before a little bit in the office, but the digital unit, the one that does 4G, that's also available cheaply?
Well, not as cheaply. No? I mean, the one that doesn't do LTE is 150 euros, and the other one costs like four times the amount. I think, and not in that quantity. You see them, but not in the quantity. So if I go to one of the refurbished retailers right now, the 2G stuff, I can buy 200 units or so. They have them in stock. And for the 4G, of course, the probability of those being phased out is not so high yet as the 2G elements.
And what kind of a state are we in actually being able to use that at some point in the future?
Which?
The 4G, the LTE hardware.
Well, that's something we can discuss with Sukchan and next EPC, maybe. Dieter also did some experiments some years ago. You as well? Kevin as well. Okay, so Kevin and Dieter. I cannot say anything. I don't have personal experience with LTE Ericsson equipment. But I have a feeling that with next EPC, we're probably not so far away from being able to use the Ericsson LTE modules. Okay, any other Ericsson questions? As I said, I have some equipment. It's already in Berlin, so tomorrow you can have a look at it if you want. I think I also have some pictures somewhere of the PCBs inside. Have to dig them out. Okay, good. Then that concludes this talk.